From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
I am Jennifer Harpster, a reference and research specialist for the Science, Technology, and Business Division here at the Library of Congress. I'd like to welcome you to today's program, Climate and Wildfires in the 21st Century. This program is presented through a partnership between our division and NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, and this is our eighth year of partnering with Goddard. It is my pleasure today to introduce Douglas Morton. He is a physical research scientist and a forest carbon expert with Goddard's Earth Sciences Division. Dr. Morton received a bachelor's degree with high honors in environmental studies and a minor in chemistry from Dartmouth, a master's in forest ecology from Yale, and a doctorate in geography from the University of Maryland at College Park. His research interests focus on how fires contribute to global change, with a specific emphasis on the roles of land use and climate that influence fire activity around the globe. He has been researching carbon emissions from tropical deforestation and fire activity in the Brazilian Amazonia since 2000, and is part of the research team for Global Fire Emissions Database, or GFED, which is an effort to combine multiple sources of satellite data to better understand fire activity, greenhouse gas emissions from fires, and changes in savanna and tropical forest ecosystems that follow fire events. He's also a technical member of Silva Carbon, which is a multi-agency cooperative that helps countries monitor their forest and terrestrial carbon activities. I should also note that he helps to mold the minds of University of Maryland's budding scientists as an adjunct assistant professor with the Geography Department. Morton has presented at his work at numerous conferences and meetings that span the globe, from the U.S. to South America and Europe. He has also published his research in many peer-reviewed journals, including but not limited to Nature Geoscience, Forest Ecology and Management, and Ecology Letters. So today we're going to learn about projections of fire activity using NASA's satellite data and climate models, which have predicted drier conditions across the United States and other fire-prone landscapes in the coming decades, which then in turn might increase the frequency in extreme events, or what people are starting to call megafires. And now please join me in welcoming Dr. Douglas Morton to the Library of Congress.
Thank you, Jennifer, and thank you all for joining us today. I'm very excited to have a chance to share some of the exciting research that's done with NASA satellite data about a very important topic. The opportunity today to share a little bit more about how we approach this question of studying how wildfires today are different from those during the satellite era, which stretches back on my watch to the early 70s, and will continue as we observe our landscapes as well as fire and fire activity from many of our space-based satellite sensors. So before I go on, I would like to make sure that I have a chance to recognize the fact that the research that I do at the Goddard Space Flight Center and the projects that I participate in are really a collaborative effort. This work is done in partnership. Jennifer mentioned the Global Fire Emissions Database, or the GFED group, which is a group of experts from the US and Europe with expertise in atmospheric chemistry, satellite remote sensing, fire ecology, and global climate models. I also work closely with colleagues at the University of Maryland and NASA, and I've listed a couple of my colleagues and collaborators in Brazil. I should also mention that the family of scientists at Goddard is enormous and very talented. I work with 10,000 people that are building rockets, Mars rovers, new space telescopes, as well as trying to help communicate the science that we do at Goddard. So today you'll see some examples from the Science Visualization Studio. One of our most important contributions, I think, is to help provide a package where the public has the opportunity to experience and understand how NASA satellite data fit into our understanding from the scientific standpoint, but also their daily lives. You may be more familiar with NASA satellite data through Google Earth, then through NASA portals, but I've also listed throughout the talk places where the public can access satellite data. One of the hallmarks of our science right now at NASA is that all of the data we collect are freely open to the public anywhere in the world. That's a revolutionary thing that we do to help improve the quality and the availability of science data, and I think it's something that we have to highlight as we describe how fire and other important earth science topics are important for us here in the United States and elsewhere around the world. So today in my talk, I'd like to provide a little bit of an introduction to how we use satellite data, or what I've called here remote sensing, which is technically something that could occur from space or an aircraft or even a remote instrument like a meteorological station. How do we study fire from space? And then I'd like to walk through a couple of our recent studies that help characterize the trends in fire activity across the globe, with a specific emphasis on North America, the United States, as well as how we're taking that information, understanding the trends through the recent past up to the present, as a way to help project the likelihood of changes in fire activity going forward. And I'll end with a few ideas for where things are going now in the field and some promising areas for future directions. One of the huge advantages of looking down at the Earth from space is that we really do maintain a global perspective, something that's essential to the work that I do, trying to understand how Earth science fits into the bigger picture of our Earth as a system. This example shows you a mosaic, a series of satellite images capturing the global extent of vegetation, an image that until we launched our Earth-observing satellites was impossible to produce either for our own enjoyment, looking at the extent and the diversity of ecosystems, or for our scientific use. And of course, we're not just looking down from space during the day, we're also looking down from space at night. And some of the most important imagery we collect from our satellites occurs on the dark side of our overpass as our satellites orbit the Earth. This example shows the extent of night lights, the cities and urban infrastructure around the world. It also captures a series of extensive wildfires in the outback of Australia. No, those are not megacities in the outback of Australia. Those were fires that were burning during the nighttime overpasses and collected as persistent sources of light. One of the other elements of the work that I do and others at NASA, let me see if I can get this started, is to understand, obviously, the natural world and how our human societies fit into the picture of changes in the Earth system. This video shows one day of every plane flight around the globe. This was put together in anticipation of the Conference of the Parties, the climate change negotiations in Copenhagen in 2009, and it really highlights our global interconnectivity. Today, many of the fires I'll talk about are started by humans on purpose for agricultural management or expansion of agricultural activities. So understanding the trends, the driving trends of agricultural expansion and the market drivers of our land use and land cover change are as important as understanding how climate fits into the picture of our understanding of fire. We have 20 Earth-observing satellites that are flying right now. And I've shown you an example. All of them have acronyms, and I don't have time to go into all of them today. But the ones that I've underlined in red contribute specifically to our understanding of fire and fire processes. And today, I'll talk about how we're using different satellites to put together three different parts of the fire picture. One is to identify actively burning fires. As our satellites are overpassing, detecting the energy that's released from that fire, which is different from the areas around it. The second approach is to take images that can compare an ecosystem before and after a fire and allow us to map out the area that's been burned. And still additional sensors here are used to characterize the smoke and greenhouse gas emissions that are released by those fires. So we're combining different satellite sensors to take a look at the areas that are actively burning, to track that burning day by day through burned area, and then to identify and trace the emissions that come from those fires as it circulates around the globe, impacting air quality and other important components of understanding the contributions from those smoke aerosols and greenhouse gases to the global picture. Our satellites are orbiting about 400 miles above the Earth, flying about 17,500 miles an hour. You'll notice that a number of these satellites are actually all orbiting in a coordinated orbit. And that's because part of the work we do to study the Earth system requires that we're able to collect data from different types of sensors at about the same time as these satellites orbit the Earth. It's also important to know that Although we provide daily coverage of the global Earth's surface with some of our most important monitoring systems, we have an opportunity to capture those images twice during the day and twice during the night. At 17,500 miles an hour, I can't sit and watch a fire as it burns. I can tell you where it was at 10:30 in the morning, I can tell you where it was at 1:30 in the afternoon, and then you gotta wait. So it's an important element of how we do our science that we're able to capture the characteristic effects of fire at these intervals. And then we need to have additional tools, like our computer models, to help us understand how those areas are changing in between our satellite overpasses. One of the most remarkable data sets that come from NASA satellite data are detections of actively burning fires. I'm showing an example of the monthly active fires here in red. The vegetation changes from the southern hemisphere to the northern hemisphere of Africa are shown in shades of green, and you can see how fire follows the end of the rainy season with the extent of vegetation, moving in opposite patterns between northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere parts of Africa. Africa accounts for about 2/3 of all of the burning that happens on the globe, and about 50% of the fire emissions that come from all types of fires. Often called the fire continent, it's pretty clear to see as you watch through these monthly step of active fire detections how critical it is to identify the extent and the number of fires across these different ecosystems. One of the most remarkable things is that within hours of a NASA satellite overpass, park and other proper or resource managers across Africa, South America, the United States, and elsewhere receive a text message with the location of actively burning fires that are within their areas of management. So direct outreach from NASA satellite data in near real time. It's become an incredibly important component of identifying and making fire management decisions, especially for remote regions of Southern Africa or South America. This is a look at fires over the last 10 days. All right, well, not last 10 days, it ended on Tuesday. I had to put together my slides before I could do this work. So this map shows in shades of red and yellow the concentration of fire activity around the globe over the last 10 days. And so even though fire may not be a day-to-day reality for those of us living in the Washington area, fire is absolutely critical to the daily lives of people living across the savanna and forest frontier regions, where fires, especially in this part of the southern hemisphere fire season, are concentrated across areas of the Brazilian Cerrado, the Amazon arc of deforestation, southern Africa, and Australian savannas. So active fires are just one part of the picture. The other component is to understand these fires, once they've been detected, how big an area did they burn, and what kind of changes did they invoke in the ecosystems? This is an example from a satellite that launched last year. This is the latest generation of Landsat satellites, Landsat 8, that captured a fire on the Kenai Peninsula in Alaska in May of this year. And on the left-hand side, you can see what we call a visual composite. This is what your eyes would see if you were looking down from space on the Landsat satellite. And what you're drawn to, of course, is the characteristic smoke plumes and pyrocumulus clouds forming over this burned area. On the right-hand side, you can see the way we used satellites like the Landsat series to look at longer wavelengths, where our eyes are not sensitive, to help characterize, in this case, from the near-infrared wavelengths, the areas of burned vegetation as compared to unburned vegetation. Those are the black areas. And your eyes can even make out the trail of actively burning fire front and those brightest colors of red here in the infrared imagery. We can use this kind of satellite imagery coverage to characterize in detail the extent of burning over any one fire. We can also put that together over time to characterize how fires affect ecosystems around the globe. And this top image shows, on average, the extent of burned area across the globe. I mentioned how important Africa is, but there are other regions of the globe, in particular savannas, that have very large areas of burning. That's one of the things that's actually needed as an ecosystem to maintain a savanna, is a regular fire return interval that helps balance out the growth of shrubs and grasses. But you see other areas across the boreal forests in Siberia and northern portions of China, as well as small but isolated pockets of boreal forest burning across North America. This global picture is really what helps us understand how fire fits into our understanding of the Earth system. But it's not enough just to know the extent of burning in these different ecosystems. We're also interested in understanding how these different fires are releasing small particles, like small fine particles of PM2.5, which is known to be an important component of air quality. This was a case about a year ago where fires in Riau province in Sumatra inundated Singapore with smoke for 2 weeks, raising air quality to unhealthy levels. This kind of long-distance transport of fire emissions is important as we think about questions of air quality, also questions about ecosystem science and greenhouse gases. The long-distance transport of black carbon burning from boreal forest fires onto ice sheets, in particular the Greenland ice sheet, is one of the important components of how fires can contribute to long-distance melting of the Greenland ice cap. In the specific case of looking at health impacts, some of my colleagues have worked to understand how do fires contribute to additional deaths across regions where fires are common. This map on the top shows you the extent of PM2.5. That's the finest particulate matter, which is an important component of respiratory illnesses, asthma, and other related diseases. And on the bottom panel shows you the fraction or the number of additional deaths each year based on fire carbon emissions releasing those fine particles in areas where there's a concentration of people. The release of smoke from those fires is also a way in which fires are fertilizing other downwind ecosystems. So fires release nitrogen and phosphorus that's stored in those plants and blows downwind. And so in these maps, the left-hand panels show the total amount of nitrogen that's being released from fires. The middle panels in blue show the extent and the concentration of nitrogen that's deposited downwind from those fires. And the panels on the right-hand side show for Africa, South America, and Southeast Asia, the net winners and losers. And what you see in Africa, for example, is that extensive burning across the savanna regions in the northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere are actually fertilizing the tropical forests of the Congo Basin and the highly productive fisheries off the West African coast. These couplings in the Earth system are fascinating. If we think about how efforts to control fire activity influence not only those local ecosystems, but the long-distance effects, positive or negative, for both ecosystems and human societies. One of the things that is, again, the hallmark of NASA Earth Science is that our goal is to take the observations we can make with each of our satellite systems, our understanding of the Earth as a system, and put that together in a model like this. Here, fires are shown in red, fire emissions are shown in shades of green, and we're combining that information with other sources of aerosols, like dust in colors of yellow, sulfate aerosols in white, and sea salt in blue, to get a better picture of how fires fit into the global circulation of atmospheric aerosols, and what that means for how aerosols interact with clouds and other components of the Earth system that we couldn't study if we couldn't put together this whole picture. My role in understanding how fires fit into this picture is then passed on to colleagues who are curious and interested to understand how those particles from fire are interacting with the ice sheets, as I mentioned, or are interacting to prevent clouds from forming. This type of Earth science is fundamentally depends on having a time series of satellite information. And it's a really fun team to be a part of in the work that we do at Goddard. You need three things for a fire. You might need more if you wanted to cook something on that fire, but let's start with what you're going to need to burn something. You need to have something to burn. We call that fuels. You need to have a source of ignition, whether that's human or natural, like from lightning. And you need to have suitable climate conditions that allow that fire to start and burn over a period of time. We typically think about this fire triangle when we start to look at how different areas are experiencing more or less fire over time. And one of the things we can do with the time series, the record of satellite data we have, is try to understand for areas that are experiencing more fire or less fire, whether that's happening through a change in the fuels, a change in the climate, or change in ignition sources. And today I'm going to focus in primarily on this relationship between fuels and climate, as we're looking towards future projections of how changing climate might influence the extent of fire activity. But it's also important, we really can't ignore the ignitions component, because more and more, fire activity around the globe is controlled by human behavior. And so by ignoring the economic drivers of changes in fire activity, or ignoring the other sources, intentional or accidental, of human fires, we're missing out on the third part of this triangle, without which we don't get a fire. If we look globally, and I apologize, this might be a little bit small in the back, but this figure represents the trend in burning between 1997 and 2012 across a variety of major burning regions across the globe. What's interesting to note here is if you look at the top left panel, you can see that on average, the global burned area has been about constant over this time period, with perhaps a slight decline. But if you look at any one individual region, the characteristics of whether that year has been a high year or a low year for fire are in some ways in balance. And so a high fire year, like an El Nino year in Indonesia and parts of Southeast Asia, is offset by a reduction in burning in places where those same El Nino conditions bring more rain or less favorable conditions. And so if you only looked at this global picture, you would miss out on the fact that there's a general trend towards increasing fires in boreal North America. There's a general trend towards decreasing fires in an important region like the Northern Hemisphere of Africa. But again, some of these larger scale trends are offset by other parts of the same continent or other burning regions. And so being able to use satellite data to put together this global picture allows us then to understand what are the characteristics that drive these trends across important burning regions. In this example, again going back to Africa, my colleagues Niels Andela and Gita van der Werf had a recent paper that tried to look at how important changes are occurring across the burning regions of Africa. As I mentioned, Africa is primarily, accounts for about two-thirds or 70% of all the burned area around the globe. And what these different map panels show you is their analysis of the average amount of burning every year, the trends in burning, as I mentioned, an increase, those colors in red, on the southern part of Africa, and a decrease across northern Africa. And then how could they explain those trends, both by looking at the area and expansion of croplands, changes in the dynamics of precipitation. A curious thing about fire and climate is that in different ecosystems, different climate conditions are important for driving those changes. If we think about a forest, you can imagine it being ready to burn as soon as it dries out. But in the case of a savanna, bigger fires can occur after a very wet rainy season because you grow more grass. And so in those drier ecosystems, in savannas in particular, more rain can actually mean more fire. What they found in this analysis was that you could explain most of the changes in Northern Hemisphere Africa in terms of the declining amounts of fire based on the expansion of cropland. Areas that are managed, maintained for crop production, fragment the landscape, which means you have less continuous fuels for large fires. It also means that you have a bigger investment in protecting those areas from burning. And so globally, the expansion of crops which are intolerant of fire. We can think about that here as being any of the annual crops, but also some of those important tree crops, something like palm oil, are actually a fire barrier because there's such a heavy investment in fire protection to preserve those tree crops. And so agricultural expansion can be an important dynamic. In a sense, it's another proxy for firefighting. But it's also true that if you look across other regions, including Southern Hemisphere Africa, that an overall increase over this time period in rainfall, based on the shift between El Nino and La Nina conditions, which is characteristic for this time period, is the best explainer of why you have an increase in fire activity across the savanna regions of Southern Africa. So putting together the picture of how satellite data give us an indication of increasing and decreasing trends in fire activity requires that we're cognizant of some of these land use changes associated with human activity, as well as some of the patterns in climate and fire interactions, which may not be intuitive at the first look. We had a paper this last year that looked at fire activity across the continent of the United States. 70% of the fires we detect from NASA satellites across the continent of the United States are for agricultural management and forestry. So even though we're much more familiar with the large towering wildfires in the Mountain West and drier ecosystems in the Rocky Mountains, we detect more fires across the Mississippi Basin in the southeast associated with crop production, wheat production in the northwest, or forest management across areas of loblolly pine and slash pine in the southeastern United States. So what this shows you is the total number of fire detections and a trend in those fire detections across the last 12 years. This is 2000 to 2012. This then breaks out the number of fires associated with those largest wildland fires, and you can see they're highly concentrated. And I'm not saying they're not important. They're an incredibly important part of how fires in the United States are generating carbon emissions, changing livelihoods, and forest resources. But in terms of the extent, and in some cases in terms of the opportunity for management, these areas of cropland that are managed through fire activity represent another opportunity for reducing fire activity if there's an incentive based on improving air quality or other elements of livelihoods. And what we can see if we look across the same time period is that states that enacted more strict air quality and agricultural burning requirements, including California, Oregon, and Washington, that's this class 4 in orange here, actually show a very strong decreasing trend in agricultural fire use associated with those new investment or those new laws and regulations. Areas where open burning and agriculture burning has much weaker public restrictions or public regulations show the opposite trend towards an increase overall in fire activity in those agricultural management areas. And so it's an interesting thing to point out that both for our understanding of firefighting and fire activity, but also for the potential for management, satellite data provide a very clear indication that air quality measures in parts of the western U.S. are being followed, and that in areas without strict air quality regulations, there's actually been an increase in the use of fire for management of rice, wheat, and other crops, as well as forestry. If we go back in time a bit further, now using data from NASA's Landsat series, here I'm showing the trend in burned area derived from two different sources of information. The blue curves here show the amount of burned area in these different regions. The codes here relate to the names on the right, so the southwest, northwest, southeast, northeast, and midwest, etc. We can go back to 1984 and track the annual area of burning across each of these different regions. This is some work that we did in preparation for the most recent National Climate Assessment, trying to understand how different regions are changing in their fire behavior, fire patterns. And the long time series here that comes from the Landsat data is incredibly valuable. It allows us to capture now 3 decades of changes in fire activity and changes in climate and start to tease apart how these relationships between climate and fire are similar or different across different regions in the United States. And across all of the regions, whether we're looking here at, let's not look at the Northeast. Northeast was included, but that's not an important fire region. Let's look at a place like the Midwest or a place like the Pacific Northwest or Alaska. Whether you're looking at the longer time record from Landsat or the shorter time record from another NASA satellite sensor called MODIS, you see that there's been a pronounced increase in burning, but there's still quite a significant amount of variability from year to year. One of the things that our research group was trying to understand was how much of this variability could we explain from changes in climate year to year. And it turns out that, again, across these most important burning regions, there's been a trend towards warming and drying conditions during the fire season. And so across each of these regions, one of the most important components of increasing fire activity was the trend in climate towards more burnable conditions. Here I'm using a metric which is called potential evaporation that allows us to mix together a number of the important variables for fire weather. That's temperature, relative humidity, wind speed, solar radiation, et cetera, all into one index, which essentially is a measure of dryness. And so as dryness has increased across these regions, we've seen an overall trend towards an increase in burning, consistent with a more vulnerable landscape for fire activity. If we take that information, the trends we see in climate, the trends we see in burned area, and we work to understand how that plays out into the future, we have some opportunity to evaluate how fire and climate will drive changes in fire activity across regions. In this case, I'll show some examples from North America. This animation shows the change in that dryness measure relative to 1990 as we step through the different decades. We might be stepping slowly. That's good. It won't be decadal, but it will still be a little slower than I would have expected. What we've done here is take information from 20 climate models that were prepared for the latest generation of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC's 5th assessment report. Although I may have stopped it. So let's try this again. Come on. animation will show, in colors of red, areas that are increasing in dryness based on projections out to the end of the century. Or it might actually take a century. Across all 20 of the climate models that we looked at, there's an overall trend towards increasing summertime dryness as measured in this index of potential evaporation. And that the greatest changes were actually found in more continental regions, so areas that are not as fire prone today as they're projected to be in coming decades. Areas such as the plains in the upper Midwest, regions of Ontario and Quebec. Areas where forest fires are somewhat common, but where the projections indicate a very strong trend in that continental climate zone towards drying, warming, and additional fire risk during the fire season. As we look out at an example like this, this shows for the United States our estimates of the future of burned area across the entire country. So in these two measures, the dark lines represent the observations and the dashed line our model. Essentially, how can we understand the patterns between fire and climate from the satellite data record, and how would we use those relationships between dryness and burning to understand how the climate models project an increase in climate-driven fire risk across the United States. The two lines in red and in blue show two different scenarios. The scenarios that were developed for the fifth assessment report are a little different from the scenarios from the past IPCC report. We can talk about that if there's some interest. But in general, this represents a moderate and a moderate to high rate of increased greenhouse gases and increased radiative forcing is what they represent. Essentially, a medium and a high scenario of continued global warming. And what we see across all 20 models, if we average them out, is an overall trend across the United States towards an increase in climate-driven fire risk. And what these bars on the bottom represent are the individual models themselves. The height of those bars show how many models in that year projected an amount of burning that exceeded the historic maximum. So as we move into the 2020s and 2030s, more than half of the models are showing an annual burned area based on the climate drivers alone that exceeds anything we've measured in the satellite era used to train our model. So that overall trend is driven by not just one model, but most models showing an overall increase in the risk of fire across the United States. The same is true if we look at areas of Canada, although there the increase in the annual burned area as in terms of the number of models that are capturing an increase over the historic maximum is delayed into more like mid-century. But we still see that the models in aggregate show an overall trend towards an increasing risk of fire activity based on climate alone. I think it's important to remember that although we can use the past data about burned area and climate to establish this relationship, there are quite a number of factors that ultimately play out as to whether or not any of these projections based on climate alone would actually influence the total amount of burning. In principle, something like fire suppression, but also how those same ecosystems will change over the coming decades. One of the other ways we wanted to look at the climate data and the projections from these 20 models was to understand the frequency of extreme events. How often are we seeing an event that's not just exceeding the historic maximum, but it's twice the standard deviation of the historic maximum? A 2-sigma anomaly in scientific speak, something that we haven't seen even in extreme fire years like 2012 in Colorado, 2013 in Arizona, or even the current drought in California doesn't register as a 2-sigma anomaly. So something more severe than the California drought. How frequent will those be by decade? What these maps show, again, is for this middle scenario and for a high scenario of future climate change, the total number of extreme events based on this measure in the historic period, number per decade, and how that changes decade by decade as we move out towards mid-century and beyond. And what you see is not just individual years or an overall trend towards drying, but an overall increase in the frequency of these extreme events. That is to say that among the models, we're seeing this trend towards a stronger continental climate and more extreme events in areas that are today burnable, like places like Quebec or parts of the northwestern United States. This would be a drought more severe than the California drought 5 times per decade by the close of the century. So this is a really strong projection towards warming and drying conditions and increasing dryness, which is associated with fire activity in those same regions. This question of how do extreme events come out of our fire projections is one of the sort of frontiers of climate science. And one of the ways in which we're trying to take the most recent climate projections and look at them through the lens of fire activity. It's also something which is much more easily accessible, because I can talk about trends and a little more burned area here, a little more burned area there. But when I talk about a drought that's more severe than the California drought, we have a reference point. And it changes the way we enter into the public discourse with the scientific findings like this. I do most of my work in the Amazon. And so I wanted to leave you with one Amazon example for a different timescale of how we're using satellite data to better understand and project the risk of fire activity. The Amazon region, like many tropical regions, is strongly influenced by climate phenomena like El Nino, where El Nino conditions redistribute rainfall across the tropical belt, bringing heavy, soaking, flooding rains to regions like Peru that rarely see, and Chile that rarely see that kind of coastal precipitation, and drying out important parts of the Amazon, the Congo Basin, and Southeast Asia. What this map shows is that just using measures of sea surface temperatures, that is, the measurements across the Pacific and a similar set of measurements across the Atlantic, to understand how large-scale changes in climate, those ENSO or El Nino-type climate modes, are influencing rainfall, we were able to explain 70% of the variability in fire activity across the Amazon. And the catch is that not only were we able to reproduce the spatial pattern from our predictions compared to the actual NASA satellite observations of fire activity in low fire years and high fire years like 2005, 2007, and 2010, the relationship was strongest 3 to 6 months before the fire season. And so now our observations of the sea surface temperatures, our observations of fires, our observations of precipitation and soil water that come from additional NASA satellites provided us with policy-relevant information on a timescale which might be suitable for adaptation or mitigation. If we can know in May that this is a big fire year across some portion of the Amazon basin in September and October, which is typically the peak of the fire season, we have an opportunity to share that information to make sure that that could be used by resource managers, policymakers, ministry officials, and others who might have the opportunity to allocate resources or allocate training to the regions that might be most affected by fire in a given year. And so what we've done in this case is take some of that long-term forecasting, the decadal scale changes from climate change, slow changes in atmospheric carbon dioxide that have big impacts across the globe. We've taken that down to a more policy-relevant scale where we might be able to know on an order of months about changes in risk of fire activity. So what our group did after this paper came out was actually put out a fire forecast. These radio dials show for important regions of the Brazilian, Peruvian, and Bolivian Amazon, the predicted fire activity in 2012 based on those same satellite and NOAA buoy measurements of sea surface temperatures. Kind of a risky thing to do, but we felt like our understanding of their system was growing in a way that would be policy relevant. And the good news in 2012 was we actually did quite well. So for the major burning regions, our forecast of the likely fire activity relative to the historic pattern we'd seen in fires across those regions was consistent with the actual observations when the fire season was all said and done. So our projections here are shown in orange, and the actual number of MODIS, NASA MODIS satellite fire detections, are shown in black. And we did quite well across these major burning regions. This represents the preconditions for fire across an important region like the Amazon. The climate risk based on the way rainfall has set up in the preceding wet season and how that area is preconditioned for more or less fire. There's nothing in our model about economic drivers for deforestation or changes in Brazilian policies associated with forest protection. And so there are definitely regions where the climate-driven fire risk won't represent what actually happens in terms of fire activity. We can look at like a state like Maranhão, or even portions of Peru, where growing pressure for expansion of agriculture, oil palm in particular in the case of Peru, is driving fire activity above and beyond what you'd expect from the climate risk. The human factor is an important component of fires in the 21st century. So this is our forecast for this year. This was released in June, shared with government ministers and other officials across South America, again, projecting a below average fire year for 2014. And we're in the process now of collecting and analyzing the data from the fire season to continue to revisit this question, engaging with a set of non-scientists required to make science-based decisions about fire and fire management in parts of the remote regions of the Amazon basin. One really geeky graph, and then I promise I'll talk about something else. I've talked about how different satellite sensors are important for identifying active fires, or mapping burned area, or even tracking the smoke plumes that come off those fires. But some of our information about your system comes from other NASA satellites that are more important for tracking the patterns of rainfall. We launched this year a satellite called the Global Precipitation Measurement Mission, which is a follow-on mission to a long-standing mission called TRIM that provides essential measurements over the tropical belt of precipitation, hurricanes, and the like. It also tells us where you've got rain, you may have more or less fire, as we've been talking about. We have another satellite, and this is where it gets really geeky, called GRACE, which actually measures gravity anomalies. Work with me here. What it's sensitive to is how much surface water and how that surface water is changing around the globe. Mountains mostly don't move, but water changes on seasonal timescales. And so changes in the Earth's gravity are actually related to how much water is on the surface, as ice or rain or lakes. What we can measure with GRACE is actually the memory of historic precipitation. So we can follow a drought as it occurs in a place like California, and we can follow the change between wet and dry season across the Amazon basin as the soils fill up with water, and then that water slowly runs out to the Amazon main stem and other river systems. So all I wanted to show you with this example is that we have some new satellite systems, in this case, the GRACE satellite, that allows us to have a different insight into the risk and the changing risk of fire on very short timescales. And that's super exciting, because rainfall is notoriously difficult to predict, as most people can tell you, based on whether or not it's going to rain today or tomorrow. It's also notoriously difficult to map from space, because rainfall is very spatially heterogeneous. What's not so heterogeneous is the memory of that rainfall in the soil after it's fallen, and how that persists and changes the Earth's gravity field. So this is a new and exciting way in which NASA satellite data, which are designed to look at a whole range of other processes, okay, granted, I'm a little biased, but I tend to think of them being really important for fire as well, even if that wasn't their initial launch purpose. And so one of the exciting and interesting things for me as a scientist is being able to take the information that's coming from satellite sensors that were never intended to be important for fire and finding uses for them in ways in which we would have no other measurements to satisfy that across large areas of remote regions of the Amazon or Siberia, where we don't have gauge measurements of rainfall like we do in the United States. So I wanted to leave you with a couple of interesting points and then open it up for conversation and questions. There's a range of activity going on at this interface between our scientific understanding and our public use of satellite data. It's really important as we think about some of the potential applications for how our monitoring systems providing real-time information about actively burning fires, but also these measurements of rainfall or snow depth or water storage are actually able to help inform our shorter-term forecasts and projections of fire risk. So I've talked about how water deficits are important for burning in places like the Amazon, but also, of course, in other forested ecosystems. If you can think back to that fire triangle, I've got plenty of burnable material in a tropical rainforest. I just need to let it dry out enough. Of course, in other ecosystems, like the savannas in Africa or parts of Australia, an increase in rainfall is really quite critical for understanding how much fuel could grow in these dryland systems, because if my fuels, my grass patches, are too separated, I can't carry a fire across that landscape. And still other examples that I didn't talk about here, but where there's very active research going on right now with NASA systems and other in situ or local measurements, are the role of changes in snowpack on the fire risk across those mountain systems in the western U.S. and elsewhere around the globe that are so dependent on the seasonal snowmelt for part of their water availability, both for natural ecosystems and for human uses. The long-term projections of fire activity are tricky. And I think I've given you some example of where the climate models seem to be showing some consistent projections towards warming and drying. But just understanding the climate feedbacks in those systems isn't enough to be able to predict where and when fires will occur. So tracking out the ongoing development of both policies or management, either directly managing fuels or suppressing fires, and how that couples with changes in economic growth and investments is something that involves people beyond the immediate NASA family in terms of understanding in a more integrated way the future trajectories of our human societies. There's also quite a number of exciting science areas that I didn't talk about today, partially because I thought maybe just one gray slide was already geeky enough. But the truth is that fire, in particular fire emissions, influences the Earth in incredibly diverse ways. And the long-term memory of that fire is critically important for understanding how the burn scar recovers as a forest or another vegetated ecosystem, but also how that fire changes the way in which the Earth, or the sun's light reflects and interacts with the Earth's surface. That change in albedo is what it's described as another important and long-term effect from fire activity. Critically important as we look to understand how fires are interacting with the rest of the Earth system, a topic for another day and another time. Human-dominated fire activity. My work in the Amazon is one endpoint, where 100% of the fires we detect from space are caused by human activity. 100%. Lightning is out of phase seasonally with the dry season in the Amazon when we detect all of our fires. So here's a region that's entirely managed by human activity and controlled by the human interest in using fire for management or suppressing fire in areas where it's potentially economically viable to do so. More and more, as we talk about fire, we're talking about a human-dominated fire regime. And so looking out in the 21st century, questions are about our human management of fire as much as they are about the vulnerability of ecosystems or the changes in climate that influence one or the other of those two components. The other pitch, and I'll make this as the last one, is the idea that so much of our understanding about the Earth as a system comes from the fact that we have a long time record of satellite data that allows us to revisit the 1970s, the 1980s, the 1990s, and compare them to today. Obviously, each day our satellites are collecting new information and continuing that time series, telling more of the story. But that continuity is absolutely critical as we look to understand changes which may be very subtle or highly variable. Years or regions that experience high fire in 1 year and low fire in another year, to be able to understand and link that information up over decades is quite critical if we're looking for trends. And so the ongoing collection of Earth science data from NASA satellites and other partners is really fundamental to our understanding of the Earth system and our ability to do the short-term monitoring, forecasting, and other public uses of the data that I've talked about today. So with that, I'll take any questions if you have some. Thank you.
Yeah, you could.
I've got a couple right over here, and I'll come around the other side.
And would you repeat the question?
Certainly.
You brought up a major fire disaster. How do you define that? Since you said that the dryness in California, the drought in California, it does not. Is that a Yellowstone 1988 or a Peshtigo?
The question was, how do we understand what an extreme event would look like in the case of fire activity, and whether that's similar to any other fire event? What I was describing in those model projections is not a specific event, but is actually the state of the climate system and how an entire region is experiencing fire weather conditions that are more extreme than what we've seen in the historic record. And so, although it's possible that those same drought and fire weather cases would lead to very large and damaging fires, what we're really describing with the climate data is the sort of precondition, the potential for a region to be experiencing very large damaging fires as opposed to the fires themselves.
Could you define El Niños? Mm. I've heard it for a long time.
Sure, the question was, could I define El Niños? And I think what I'll probably do is then give an example of why it's so critical for the science that we work with. So the El Niño system is described by sea surface temperatures across the tropical Pacific. An El Niño case is when warm water, which usually resides off the coast of Australia, Indonesia, and other ports of the western Pacific, sloshes, and I literally mean sloshes like your bathtub, to the eastern Pacific. And where you have that pool of warm water, you have a different amount of convection bringing rainfall to regions, especially across the coast of western portions of South America, that don't normally experience that, because typically there's upwelling, which feeds the fisheries across Peru and Chile with cold water, but that cold water pool results in less rainfall in the local region. And when I say slush, I mean we're actually using NASA satellites that look at the height of the sea surface and seeing the sea surface heights change by half a meter or more on average. So water that's normally pulled up in the western Pacific, like a big bathtub, sloshing to the eastern Pacific and staying there, those conditions end up bringing large-scale changes across the tropical belt, and then those propagate out across other parts of the globe. And the tropical zone is so critical for starting those big climate systems and rainfall events. And so not only do these events typically have a long enough duration, much longer than a weather front, so that they end up influencing our rainfall patterns over a longer period of time, 3 months, 6 months, a year, they typically end up bringing this real and dramatic and somewhat predictable shift in rainfall to places like Kenya, which flooded out in the 98 El Nino, and other regions which dry out significantly that normally see year-round rainfall, like parts of Indonesia. And so the knowledge about how a phenomenon like El Nino influences rainfall gives us an indication on that same time scale. A developing El Nino is cause for alarm across parts of Southeast Asia that are likely to dry out and become burnable in places where typically it's raining enough each month to not have fires. What's curious about our study of something like the El Nino system is that there are other related changes in sea surface temperature that are equally important for rainfall and climate systems. So you can look at the North Atlantic, the tropical North Atlantic, and that system is important for driving changes both in fires in the Amazon case and also hurricanes in the southeastern United States. So we have some work ongoing right now that looks at how there are these connected disturbances. Years that are extreme fire years in the Amazon are also years with more landfall hurricanes and more intense hurricanes across the southeastern United States. So again, back to my carbon brain, what that means is that we're releasing carbon in real time from fires, and we're damaging forests that store a lot of carbon across parts of the southeastern United States. And so there's a carbon consequence to those disturbances, which is synchronized based on sea surface temperatures in the Atlantic. Sorry, I get kind of geeked out when I talk about the Earth as a system, but you can see how this all fits together. If we have knowledge and understanding of this interaction between the ocean, the atmosphere, and the land systems, we have a lot more predictive and explanatory capability about a variety of phenomena. There were a couple questions over here in the front. So the question was, would there be a signature in the smoke based on what was actually burning, whether that was in an urban setting with houses or other anthropogenic materials, or in a natural ecosystem? There are a variety of systems that we use to monitor air quality, and most often in the case of a large urban area, we're monitoring that air quality locally with actually a piece of filter paper on a system that's designed to collect particles that are being, where the residents of that city are being exposed to that particular parcel or that type of air quality. That's a really important resource for our ability to disentangle what the components of the smoke are, whether those are hazardous based on their size, those very small particles, or other elements of their chemical breakdown, plastics, heavy metals, etc. Most of that measurement is done locally. One of the things that we're working to continue to improve from our space-based monitoring is understanding a little bit more about the characteristics of fires. But as we mix the smoke from any one individual fire across a burning region where fires are being used for agricultural management or deforestation or other purposes, what's the signal in the atmosphere is, for the atmospheric scientists, thankfully well mixed. And for the rest of us interested in trying to track down individual information about certain fire types, frustratingly complicated. What do we do today? Today we have different satellite systems that allow us to look at different parts of the smoke plume. So we have a sensor that looks at carbon monoxide. We have a new sensor we launched this year called OCO 2, which looks at carbon dioxide and methane. And as we put together the and we have another system based on partners in the European Union that looks at nitrogen oxides. And so we can put together the different chemical breakdown of those smoke plumes and have some indication about the relative contribution of different fire types. I would say that our understanding of the actual chemical breakdown and breaking it down into individual fires of urban or other origin is still something that we are unable to do from space, but certainly a growing importance as we look at how the long-distance transport of smoke emissions influences air quality for people hundreds or thousands of kilometers away. The question in the back. So the question was whether there's been some policy-relevant forecasting information based on satellite data of fire weather conditions or other precursors to a strong fire season and applied in the case of the United States. There are regions of the United States where fire activity is very predictable. Some of the predictable characteristics, for example, in places like Alaska, are driven by another sea surface temperature gradient, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which relates to how water and climate systems set up across the North Pacific. Several colleagues have, working on cases of Canadian as well as Alaskan boreal forest fires, have looked in more detail at how those climate modes conditioned by Pacific sea surface temperatures in the North Pacific present cases where you have persistent weather conditions that allow large fires to grow in places like Alaska. There's been a lot of work as well in the southwestern United States related to snowpack and how important it is to monitor the levels of snowpack across key river basins. Again, starting the season with a deficit of snow predisposes that region to drought-related consequences, including fires. And so several colleagues have focused in specifically on regional questions related to the southwestern United States and those snow-dependent ecosystems from the mountains. In general, some of the work that we did in preparation for the National Climate Assessment was trying to look out beyond those two areas that are more well studied to identify what amount of predictability there was in relation to the year-to-year variability in fire activity. And overall, we see that there's pretty good predictability based on this measure of dryness, but nothing in our research would suggest that there's a long lead time associated with those dryness conditions, because in the case of the prairies in the Midwestern United States, several weeks of dry weather is enough to allow those grass ecosystems to burn. And so the time scale between the climate phenomenon that we're able to identify and measure and the fire activity is too short. Question?
Yeah, so I'm interested in how this work is being used, if at all, within accounting programs under the Kyoto Protocol or under UNFCCC, RED or LULUCF, and what that's looking like in terms of COP20.
Question was, how does some of this research play out in a policy framework and the ongoing reporting for greenhouse gas emissions under the Kyoto Protocol and ongoing negotiations for changes or extensions of related climate treaties associated with reducing emissions from deforestation to forest degradation, which is otherwise known as RED or RED Plus, and other emphases within the international climate negotiations at the scale of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change about how carbon accounting for all different lands, not just forests or tropical forests in particular, how was this work inform some of those activities? Our ability to have those negotiations is fundamentally dependent on the free and open access to NASA satellite data. These systems require a landscape accounting of the amount of forest and the amount of forest change in the case of RED Plus. That's only possible if you have historic satellite data and contemporary satellite data with which you can identify and compare those rates of annual changes in forest cover. So I would argue that an agreement or a budding agreement like RED Plus, in the case of the international climate negotiations, fundamentally depends on NASA satellite data. And it might be the first such agreement where the ability to monitor and have not only national reporting but global transparency depends on having open access to the satellite data that we would use to characterize areas of forest cover change. The fire emissions estimates, and I didn't speak as much about our work from the GFED group, play out in the framework, play out in conversations in the scientific literature that inform the ongoing negotiations about the importance of accounting for fire as opposed to other releases of greenhouse gases. So the GFED emissions data were included in the latest IPCC report as it relates to how you would estimate how fire contributes to the overall increase in greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Again, what we sometimes call the fire fraction actually matters, because if the material in an area of deforestation is allowed to decompose, most of that carbon will ultimately be released as carbon dioxide as opposed to methane or other greenhouse gases or the aerosols we were talking about as a component of the fire process. And so whether that area of deforestation burns or simply decomposes actually makes a difference. So I would say that the scientific community is providing essential inputs into the climate negotiation process in terms of how important certain components are, tropical deforestation, for example, how important monitoring systems are, and our ability to use satellite data to have open and transparent dialogue about the different components of the greenhouse gas problem. Ultimately, I see these moving forward in the negotiations towards a post-2020 agreement. I think the opportunity that's been building with the case of tropical deforestation is very likely to be continued and expanded to consider other very important regions in terms of greenhouse gases. In my opinion, there are other areas such as peatlands, whether that's in Southeast Asia, boreal forests, or deep regions of the Amazon. Those carbon reservoirs are immense. There's more soil carbon in central Kalimantan than there's carbon stored in all the trees of the Amazon. So safeguarding carbon reservoirs is an important component of an agreement like REDD+. Safeguarding carbon stored in soils is equally important if our overall goal is to reduce the rates of greenhouse gas emissions. Question in the back.
How does your application for agenda and fire prediction tie in with the smaller applications such as the fire protection system, I think, that is really developed? What was that? How much of that big data is actually being able to feed into smaller data systems and prediction systems?
So the question was, how does some of the big data and maybe more regional scale fire prediction or fire forecasting activity feed into more local scale applications, real-time use or other uses for the data on a local scale? I'm not familiar with the particular example you mentioned in Israel, but I can describe a little bit of the handoff that occurs in some other cases. NASA satellite data provide an important precursor to a variety of decision makers. Knowing when and where fires have started within areas of their land management is the first step in making subsequent decisions about how to move forward. I sometimes describe that as sort of the fact that NASA has the tallest fire towers around. We're able to identify fires before ground systems or even other existing local monitoring systems based on our vantage point from space. And so that opportunity, I think, really does start a dialogue. And so many fire management, fire resource groups are taking NASA satellite data as one of their inputs to a local system. There are other inputs and other efforts that I would classify even under NASA's development of remote sensing capabilities. Many of those are put forward on an airplane because we have a specific place and time where we'd want to use that fire mapping capability. And so NASA participates as a science partner with other agencies in the U.S. like the U.S. Forest Service to better understand how fires are growing and changing during a fire event. Some of that is geared towards better understanding of greenhouse gas emissions or fire severity and what that means for ecosystem restoration. Other parts of that are really geared towards fire safety and how fires are expanding and spreading. The fire behavior is so critical for a land manager to understand if they're hoping to keep their firefighters safe and out of harm's way. So knowing how a fire is growing and changing is something that we can remotely sense from an aircraft or other airborne platforms in ways that represents a science partnership with the groups actually making a decision on the ground about fires. I think I'll leave that one there. Other questions? In the front.
You were talking about how NASA also uses planes. Are they, when there's a big fire that breaks out, are they kind of there along with the local people, or how do they participate?
So NASA funds a variety of different airborne instruments, and part of our development of new instruments in an airborne platform is because we want to test and evaluate how a new system might work before we launch it into space. The rockets we use to send our satellites into space are tens, if not hundreds of millions of dollars, and so we don't launch something hoping it will work. We launch something after we've tested it repeatedly. And so the airborne platform allows us to do that. But again, there's some other questions, in particular fire, where our airborne capabilities, because we're much closer to the event itself, just gives us higher resolution or more flexibility for studying something like fire. So there are NASA-funded investigators and NASA instruments that are being deployed to study the actively burning fires, to fly through the smoke plumes and collect samples to better understand what amount of carbon monoxide, methane, and other greenhouse gases are being released from that fire. Some of that is done so we can understand whether what our satellites are seeing from space is consistent with what we can measure on the ground or in the air. But many times it's because that's the most appropriate way to study that region. I'm part of a group that has a small package of instruments that's studying not actively burning fires, but the impacts from fires, historic fire activity. I have a link on the slide right now for the G-Light system, which allows us to combine a variety of different instruments in a small package. We fly it, I'll even zoom ahead here. Oops, hang on. We fly it on a small Piper aircraft shown in the bottom right. This was a campaign we did this summer where we flew 44 days across parts of interior Alaska and the Tanana River Valley with partners from the U.S. Forest Service because airborne access is so critical to studying these remote regions. Roads and rivers will only get you so far in the remote Alaska wilderness. Airborne access is what allows us to do the kind of mapping you see shown here in green, as opposed to our Forest Service field crew shown in their orange jumpsuits that had to be helicoptered out, picked up, and dropped off to get to the regions they wanted to monitor and measure. The airborne science, as I mentioned, has these different avenues within NASA, but really provides accessibility to these remote regions in ways that are just not possible on the ground or practical or at high enough resolution for our studies from space. So the airborne component is a really key part of NASA science, and it's not something I spend a lot of time talking about, but it's something that I spent a lot of time doing this last summer.
One simple question. Mm-hmm. It's not simple, but it's more like sociological question.
Mm-hmm.
When you classify fires, say wildfires, can you figure out like the King County fire that's happening right now? That was arson based, right? It started because of arson. Can you figure out if things, or maybe I'm wrong, if they were caused by natural causes or arson? Like, do you ever classify things like fires like that?
So the question was whether or not the work that we're doing with NASA satellite data is used in helping to understand the source of a fire, whether it's a lightning ignition or a human ignition or other fire types. The answer is that we spend a lot of our time working on fire types because that's critically important if we're trying to map out the ecosystem impacts or the carbon emissions from those fires. We don't enter specifically into the questions of whether an individual wildfire was started by a human activity or by lightning, but you could imagine how some of our satellite data could play into that investigation. Not only do we have other sources of satellite information that would provide information about weather fronts and systems, and you could match that up with the timing of when that fire was identified and started, but you could also imagine using other satellite information about lightning strikes themselves. We have systems and sensors that detect the flash at the top of a cloud from lightning strike, and that would allow you to, again, evaluate whether any of that was consistent with the timing of the fire. I'm not personally involved in some of those distinctions, but there are other things that we can learn from the satellite data that help us do that fire typing. I'll give you one example from our work in the Amazon. In the case of a savanna ecosystem, you can only burn it once in the same dry season, because once you burn that savanna, the grass is gone. There's nothing left to burn. But if we see fires that are detected in the same place more than once, that's very consistent with the deforestation process where a farmer on the ground has burned the area after clearing it and then piles up the woody material to burn it again to make space for agriculture or ranching or other uses of the land. So there's a very characteristic timing of those fires. If we see the same place burning four times in the same Amazon dry season, that's very characteristic of the deforestation process. And so there's some other insights we can draw from those satellite remote sensing data that don't specifically relate to any one measurement of that fire as being a deforestation fire versus another fire. So I think it's in some ways the puzzle for a scientist like myself to figure out how to use the satellite data to identify the characteristics of a specific fire type. And my rationale for doing that is to better understand the process of fire activity, the ecosystem impacts, the drivers of agricultural expansion, et cetera, as opposed to trying to fingerprint the fire as being started from arson or other human causes.
Yeah, I got confused on all the different types of wildfires.
An understandable confusion. Great.
Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.